I want to introduce you to the basics of C sharp, just the language, syntax, some of the basic code that you see and what they mean, and how to get input and make the program do something, stuff like that. So here I am on ripple.it inside my account. I'm going to go to my ripple. So I will be creating a new ripple called week 1, demo 1. So I choose the language of C sharp, week 1, demo 1. Because Ripple knows that I'm using C sharp as the language, it is going to create the basic Hello World program for me. Every single time I try to create a new project, this happens automatically. So it looks like the internet is iffy. Let's try one more time. Okay, so just make sure that you have good internet, otherwise this is not gonna work. So that is my main.cs. Let me run the program. You always want to do this step. So my program gets compiled. Then this is the command for compiling my program. So what I mean by compiling a program is that all of this code first gets converted to binary, and that is the main.exe. And then the compiler runs this executable so that we can see this is all in binary. We can make out it's all gibberish, but when you run the code, the program spits out hello world as we wrote in here. Some programs like Python use interpreter, so as you type it, the program gets executed right away, so there is no exe created in the middle. But C sharp uses a compiler, so all the code changes, once you write all of it, the whole thing will be validated. So the validation doesn't happen line by line. So that is the difference between C sharp and a compiler-based language and an interpreter-based language. So for C sharp, you have to write the code, it gets converted to an executable, and then the executable is run. So if you want someone not to see your source code, but just to use the code you've generated, then you give them only this main.exe, and they should be able to run the program and see the same output. So that is the first thing I wanted to make you understand, that we are using a compiler. That is why you see this main.exe here. Second thing I want you to think about is some of the code that is generated. So this first line is called using. It is the directive. What I mean by that is when you say using system, you are saying, hey, I want to use whatever code is inside the system library. In your first chapter in the book, you can see information about the .NET Common Language Runtime and all the libraries that are available. So these are system libraries that are already available. This is what makes coding fast in the current day. So if you were to do all the things in C or some other language like that, which does not have a lot of pre-built libraries, it would take you a lot more time to do even simple functionality because you have to write code from scratch. This is more like buying a packet of a ravioli that's frozen. So all you have to do is thaw it or put it in the microwave, add some pre-made sauce, and you're good to go. So this is something like that. So it is a rapid application development environment. That is one of the good things about C sharp, which means C sharp comes with a lot of libraries that are pre-built. The one downside of using ripple.it is you just cannot use the IntelliSense, which would be automatically showing you all the libraries that are available. But I don't think that is such a big deal, especially for an introductory course. Okay, so this system is a library that has a lot of functionality, including this console. So there is a class inside the system called console. And it has a method called WriteLine, console.WriteLine. Even though you didn't do anything, you are able to make it write Hello World to this console here. And that is made possible because you're using this library. So you are borrowing this functionality to your requirements. So that is what the first line means. So system is something basic that we always use for the basic functionality, especially if you are doing a console application. So there are other libraries like collection, data. Depending on like what kind of code you're writing, you will add more and more libraries. So that is what the first line means, this line. Okay, so this is class, main class. So this is an entry point. So let me see. Let me just bring the whiteboard here for a second. Okay, here's my whiteboard. So you think of your program as this black box here. It gets some input and then it gives an output. Okay, so this is what a program basically does. So your program should have one entry point and one exit. Okay. So you could have like many files, many .cs files in your project, but at the end of the day, there should be only one entry point. So that is what is happening here in our case with the Okay, I have way too many windows open. Yes. So this is one entry point. I might have more files here as we go through the course, but it doesn't matter. Those files are going to be helping, or they are going to be called from this main.cs. If you create the same project in Visual Studio 2019 or some other version of Visual Studio, you will be getting a file called program.cs. It doesn't matter, it's just the name, as long as you have like one entry point. So this program, when you start it, there should be only one place it always starts, which would be the main.cs, so this class. Okay, and then it can have one exit. So there should always be an exit, no matter how many paths you branch off. Finally, there should be one way to exit, okay? I'm not saying there should be only one input and one output. I'm just saying there should be only one entry point here. So this entry point, in our case, this is called as main.cs. So the main.cs, you can have other code CS files. It doesn't matter. But at the end of the day, we all have to come through this one entry point and one exit. So that's the second thing I want to talk about. For the time being, we are going to ignore this. What a class is, what does it mean by a class? We are going to ignore that for the time being. Always, your code should go between these two curly braces. Your code, let's just move that so you can see, you should be writing code between these two curly braces. Okay, so with C#, the language syntax is, if you have multiple lines of code that has to be like, you know, inside in a logical grouping, we use curly braces. So for a single line, it has to always end in a semicolon. Okay? When you have like multiple lines and then these go inside other statements that we'll be seeing in the future, they can go inside curly braces like that. Only depending upon the situation. So like if you have an if condition or something, you have multiple lines. For example, this static void main method does not have just a single line, it can have multiple lines.
and it could have multiple things going on. So all those belong to this method called the main. All of these four lines are inside this method called main. So because of that reason, we have to use curly brace. Without the curly brace, only the first line will be included, the rest will be ignored. So that is the reason why the curly braces are really important. Okay, so now we are good. So here is another thing. The number of curly braces is also important. So for example, if I remove this curly brace, then I run the code. So this is giving me an error, one error. That's because, see, I have one, two curly braces, and then in the closing, I only have one. So the number of opening and closing curly braces should tally all the time. If not, it's going to give us an error. Same thing with the semicolon. If we don't have semicolon, let's see. So it says semicolon expected. So all statement is a single line, should end with a semicolon. Okay. So that is this another thing I want to talk about. So in the next video, I'll show you more about how to write input and output and all that. Thank you.